Time. It's running out as the ARCA Remax Series heads for the home stretch. Six races to go, and the man who's dominated the series in the past looks to have found his stride just in time. The checkered flag will fly for Frank Kimmel, winning career number 71. Frank Kimmel has won the last two races, but gutsy rookie Michael McDowell continues to stay within striking distance in the points. McDowell has been magic under the lights. A photo finish to Kimmel in Iowa, second in Berlin, and the win in Kentucky. But this time, he'll need to work that magic again if he wants to gain ground on the red-hot 46. With 12 different winners in 17 races, tonight could be anybody's show. It's time for the ARCA Remax Series to go racing right now at Gateway. Welcome to the Gateway to the West. It's the Gateway ARCA 150 for the ARCA Remax Series, race number 18 of the 2007 season. And the points race is really starting to heat up. Hello, everyone. I'm Rick Allen alongside of Phil Parsons. Now, we come to Gateway International Raceway, and this is a unique racetrack, Phil.
Very unique. Much like Pocono, even though it's only half as big, these guys will shift here. Mm-hmm. We have a very, very tight turns one and two, as you can see right there, right up your screen, 11-degree banking. Use all the brakes you have getting down to turn number one. Long straightaways, tight turn three and four, not quite as tight as one and two, but these guys, the speed disparity is so great from the straightaway to the corner that they will actually shift. Some guys will shift on both straightaways, downshift into the corner. Mm-hmm. Some guys will only do it one time, but just about everybody here in the field will be shifting, and that may give the road race contingent that we have right in the field a little bit of an advantage, and we'll talk about that a little bit later.
Well, we're under the lights here for the ARCA Remax Series, and it was a one-day show. Again, we have practice, qualifying, and then the race as it is tonight. We take a look back at qualifying that took place under the sun earlier. It was a little bit warmer when Josh Wives heated up the track as he was able to grab his first career pole in the ARCA Remax Series. Second quick on the racetrack today was Mark Mitchell in that number four.
Yeah, good job. Second place finisher earlier this year at Daytona. Has his best career start, as you mentioned. So both guys in the front row, best career starts here in the ARCA Remax Series.
And amazingly enough, we're talking about a guy like Josh Wise and Mark Mitchell. We haven't talked a lot about Josh Wise's teammate, like Michael McDowell, who we've talked about quite a bit in the past because he was the one who's been challenging Frank Kimmel. Jim Trado.
Michael McDowell's about to climb into his car. He's not at the head of the grid for a change. Seven times this year, he's won the pole position. But tonight, Michael, you're back in 10th. I'm wondering, big picture and the race tonight, are you worried at all starting 10th?
No, we had a great car. Eddie Sharp Racing, Z-Line Design, Mission Residential Dodge was awesome in race runs. A little bit off in qualifying, but that's okay. We haven't won a race yet from the pole. So hopefully we can get our third win tonight and prove that to be true.
He'll get strapped in, guys. Four spots better than the man standing with Ray Dunlap, Ray?
Well, that'll be Frank Kimmel. He's actually sitting by here, Jim, as he's climbed into his race car. But this is a new race car to this team, and they got it right after a big crash at Pocono. And after that race, Frank Kimmel's point lead had gone all the way down to 20. But the last two races have been victories. And, Frank, I got to wonder, you start midfield tonight. Do you chase a victory tonight, or are you points racing?
Well, you know, Ray, you know me and been around this a long time, but we pretty much point race every night. But, you know, the best way to gain the most points, as they say, is to win the race. And, you know, this Pork Ford Fusion is really a good race car, and it's kind of turned around our program here and didn't qualify all that great today, but I think we got a pretty good car, so hopefully we can get up there.
Two consecutive victories for the number 46 team, and they are back on top of the points, guys.
Frank Kimmel with a 95-point lead over Michael McDowell, and we talk about where Frank Kimmel is normally good, every racetrack Frank Kimmel is good at. But here, he's never finished out of the top 10, Phil.
As you can see, he won back in 2001. 10th was his worst finish here out of the five races back last year. But very, very competitive field of cars here at Gateway.
This points battle has really gone down to two guys. We've got Frank Kimmel and Michael McDowell, again, only separated by 95 points. Will that get closer tonight? We're going to find out right after this.
Yeah.
Welcome back. Just outside of St. Louis for the Gateway ARCA 150. Your RE/MAX ARCA starting grid will roll across the top of the screen again. Josh Wise, Mark Mitchell making up row number one tonight. We talked a little bit, and you touched on the fact that there are some drivers that have some road racing experience. One of those is 18-year-old Colin Brown. Now, he's making his first ARCA RE/MAX Series start tonight, and so he's got his, I guess, hands full with a field that is very impressive. Right, Ray Dunlap?
Absolutely, Rick, and I talked with Colin Brown just a few moments ago. I said, tell me just a little bit about how road racing and those type of Rolex cars are similar to stock car racing and the car that you're sitting in right now. He says, I can summarize it very easily, Ray. They've got four wheels and a steering wheel, and other than that, they're nothing alike whatsoever. He said he had a great time today, though, trying to get his feet wet in this type of racing. He's going to run two more races this year, hoping to go to Chicagoland and Talladega. Rick?
Yeah, and Ray, they're talking about a full 2008 series season for him next year. So a big career move for Colin Brown. Take a look at some of these other Rolex Series alumni.
Yeah, we talk about Michael McDowell all the time. Justin Marks had his career best finish last week, finished second, a great run at Milwaukee. And Andy Lally had a top 10 in his first ever ARCA RE/MAX start after having a top 10 in the Busch race at Watkins Glen just a few weeks ago.
Hey, Jim Tredo, what else you know about Justin Marks?
Well, Justin Marks finished an incredible second-place finish a week ago. A lot of momentum coming into this race with that very same ex-Ganassi race car. But he, of course, has a road racing background, which plays into his hand here. He went in detail to show me physically what he'll do when he goes into turn one. He's going to try to get shifting done before he enters the corner under braking. He also did try and practice the fact that if he has to pass someone in mid-corner, he may do a mid-corner shift in one and two. So that will play into his hand as he tries to maneuver around this 1.25-mile racetrack. So Justin Marks, high on confidence from the second place run a week ago, the very same race car he hopes to put at the front once again tonight.
Justin Marks, coming off of that career best finish from a week ago, looks to get his car one spot better, maybe find victory lane tonight under the lights for the Gateway ARCA 150. We'll see the green flag when we come back to Gateway. Coverage of the ARCA RE/MAX Series from Gateway is presented by RE/MAX. Outstanding agents, outstanding results. And brought to you in part by Prescription Flomax. Cars rolling around the grid here at Gateway International Raceway. We'll ride along with a few different cars tonight, one of those being Gabby DeGarlo. She's driving the Great Clips Chevrolet tonight. She'll start in the 33rd position, so we'll see if she can make her way through the field. Actually, three females in the race tonight, Gabby being one of them.
We're also going to ride along with that 11th car, the Nortrack Shell Rotella T Chevrolet for Brian Silas. Brian's going to start in the 22nd position. As you can see, his best finish this year, eighth twice, but he's had a couple good runs going, maybe possible top five finishes, and had some trouble late. So Brian Silas looking to improve on that eighth place career best here tonight.
We've got a good vantage point of what it's going to look like up front. We're riding along with Mark Mitchell in that number four Aragon Dodge. He starts in his career best position today in second. And we will see if he has got anything for pole sitter Josh Wise at the start of this race. Have the opportunity to ride along with him. Now we take a look at our race analysis for tonight's race. It's 120 laps, 150 miles. Now, we think the pit window right around 70 to 75 laps.
Yeah, most of the teams talk about making a couple pit stops. Maybe, you know, maybe one. You could do it on one pit stop, certainly. But most of the teams talking about possibly two pit stops, four tires.
Before the green flag flies, let's get final thoughts from Ray Dunlap.
You know, Rick, whenever you get ready to chase a championship in the ARCA RE/MAX Series, you got to put a big asterisk by race 17 through 20. That's because these teams will be running four events in the schedule of 13 days. Last Sunday, they were at Milwaukee. Tonight, here at Gateway. Then on Monday, for a Labor Day Classic, it's off to DeCoin on the mile dirt. And then the next Saturday, it'll go to Chicagoland Speedway. These four races are the four that you've got to be prepared for if you're going to have a shot at winning the ARCA RE/MAX Series title. Jim?
And right, for Justin Allgaier, it's more than getting a chance to race. He'll have, matter of fact, race a midget race and a Silver Crown race in DeCoin before the ARCA boys rolling on Monday. But here at Gateway International, Jason Allgaier has run four times now. He's never qualified outside the top 10, including tonight, but he's never finished better than 25th. He said, all I did during practice, me and Larry Moore worked on turn one, entry to turn one and exit off for turn two. I think that's the key to run tonight. Stay on the bottom because that will give you a lot better track position if you can keep it down low in that tricky first corner.
And that's a great point, Phil. I mean, this is a tricky racetrack. A lot of guys were saying that they wanted to be good in one and two, and they're almost not giving up in three and four, but they're not working so hard with three and four as they think one and two will be the place where they can make moves.
Yeah, most of the cars are talking about, teams are talking about being real slow off of turn two. That's why these guys are shifting here, because the corner is so tight, they need that extra bit of oomph up off the corner. So it's going to be interesting to see the guys that shift on both straightaways and the guys that only shift on one straightaway.
Four cars off, 40 cars all in line as they come to the green flag. We're underway at Gateway. Good start for Josh Wise. He will take the point. Mark Mitchell will fall in just behind him. Justin Allgaier. Michael Annette, another name that kept coming up in the garage as the car to watch tonight.
And only two starts before for Michael Annette, but he finished third in his very first start from the pole at Iowa Speedway. Look at Michael McDowell on the inside.
McDowell already making it two and three wide as they went down the backstretch. Now he's on the inside and looking at the back bumper of that 39 of Pete Shepard, who looked very strong earlier today in practice.
Yeah, Michael was so confident in his race setup for this car. He knew he gave up a little bit qualifying, but as you can see, Brian Silas right there in the Shell Rotella T Nortrack Chevrolet. But Michael McDowell really felt like he had the best race setup of anybody here.
A lot of cars to get by there for Brian Silas. That's the vantage point he has. Justin Allgaier and Martin Mitchell battling for second right now. Allgaier to the inside. He'll try to take the position away.
Yeah, Michael Annette is going to try to follow him by. Justin Allgaier was so good, as Jim told us, has always been qualified well, but never really parlayed that into a good finish. And talking to his dad before the race, and he said, we need a good finish here. We need this car for next week at Chicagoland.
Look at Michael Annette, the way he's able to pull away from Martin Mitchell when they came out of that turn.
You can listen to the RPMs in that engine right there as he comes off the corner. Mark Mitchell, that thing is really, really lugging coming off the corner there.
They talk about wanting to brake hard before they start turning. A lot more difficult to be braking as you're trying to turn.
It really is, especially down in turn number one. You stand on the brakes going down into turn number one. If you use all you got, as we see Michael Annette look to the inside of Justin Allgaier. Just because Justin Allgaier is up, that isn't necessarily a bad thing. You can get some pretty good grip up in the middle of the racetrack, especially down in one and two.
Ray Dunlap.
Rick, whenever you look at the most laps led at this speedway, that belongs to Joey Miller. He won here in 2005 and he led 107 laps. Well, the car that he used to win that night is underneath the wheel of Michael Annette. That number 32 car is from Country Joe Racing. It's the exact same car that Miller used right here at this speedway to gain that victory. And Michael Annette comes into this race with a great deal of confidence, even though this is just his third career start in the series.
I saw Joey Miller down in the garage here. I think Joey maybe going to run the DuCoin race on Monday, the Labor Day Classic, as Ray called it, up in DuCoin.
Yep. Again, we talk about this being just the third start for Michael Annette, a third and an eighth in his previous starts. And we see Aaron Crocker in that number 98 trying to make the pass on Jeremy Clements.
Yeah, Jeremy Clements had that big win his last race out at Nashville. Came oh so close to Pocono, didn't quite get it done. But there's that 46 of Frank Dimmel, winner of the last two races.
I tell you what, Jeremy Clements right there, he wanted nothing to do with being away from that yellow line. He turned hard in front of Frank Kimmel so that he could get right behind that 98 of Aaron. Now Aaron Crocker moves up a little bit. We see Jeremy Clements look to the inside for the pass.
Yeah, Jeremy gets a pretty good bite coming off of turn number two. See if he can stay up there with Aaron as they get down into turn number three. See if Aaron gives him a little bit of room. No, she was able to pull down in front of him. Good hard racing right around the 10th, 11th position right there for Jeremy Clements and Aaron Crocker.
Side-by-side racing, Justin Marks on the inside of Frank Kimmel. And this is a racetrack, a very flat racetrack. If you've got a good handling car, you can pass people. But if it's ill handling, you're really trying to get out of the way.
Oh, you really are, and it's hard to get out of the way. There's really no place to hide here at this racetrack. But as you can see, Frank Kimmel leading Justin Marks, and there's Colin Brown, yep, and that number 99 Roush Fenway car
making his way up toward the front. And the guy who's leading it at the front, Josh Wise, in the number 22, leading here at Gateway International Raceway. We'll be back with more racing for the ARCA Series right here on Speed. Welcome back. Josh Wise still out in front of the field. Justin Allgaier holding on to second. Michael Annette's dropped to third. Then it's Mark Mitchell and Dexter Bean. Actually, Michael Annette's moving up. It was Mark Mitchell who's dropped back. Josh Wise already putting a few cars a lap down.
I tell you, a guy that's having a good run right now is Dominic Cassola. Great qualifying effort, qualified in the sixth position. He finished eighth for his career best just a few weeks ago at Pocono, so it should be no big surprise that Dominic is running well here. Again, we talked about at the very top of the show how much this racetrack is like a small Pocono, about half as big as Pocono, right, but these guys shifting. Dominic Cassola has a great run going.
And Josh Wise continuing to lead the field around here. You see the Remax running order on the top of the screen. Cassola in sixth. McDowell, second in the points, is running seventh. And rounding out our top 10 is Brian Keselowski. Where's Frank Kimmel? Well, in 13th right now. So Frank Kimmel chasing Michael McDowell again. 95 points separated the two of them in the points championship coming into this race. Kimmel looked very strong in practice, but Michael McDowell, obviously another one of those cars that we would expect to run toward the front. Ray Dunlap.
Well, you got to watch the brake temperature on this racetrack, and Patrick Donahue, his crew chief, is telling him that it's looking like your rotors are a little bit too hot right now. You might want to ease off on your entry into the corners. Now, Michael McDowell is running an overdrive on his transmission, which allows him not to get into the chip too much when he comes down the front straightaway. But sometimes that means your entry speed's a little too hard, and you get to get really hard on the brakes. And these guys talked about it all throughout practice today. Easy on the brakes. We got to make sure we finish this race and every race throughout the course of the season. So Patrick, the crew chief, certainly has his eyes on it.
Another big thing as far as coming to a racetrack like this, so flat, you've got to slow down. I mean, they're upwards of 180 miles an hour, 185 when they're down the straightaway, and they got to slow way down on these flat turns.
Yeah, Michael McDowell, you can see the brake rotors right there glowing, but he is one of the guys that is shifting twice. So that transmission will actually help his brakes a little bit. That will help the car slow down a little bit versus going in there in a turn three like a lot of drivers will, just leave it up in high gear. They don't get that extra added slowing down factor from the engine. So Michael McDowell is one of the guys that feels very, very comfortable shifting. Actually feels like it helps his rhythm. So he will do it on both straightaways. He will upshift, center the straightaway, and downshift as he gets down into the corners.
Here's a battle for 10th right now. Brian Keselowski in the number 5. Then it's Brian Clausen in the 40 just behind him. And rounding out that 12th position is Frank Kimmel in the 46. So those three battling for the top 10 spot. Again, going by the 4-lap traffic of Norm Benning in the 84. Jeremy Clements with problems in the 3. What's going on, Jim?
The indication is the left front brake lever may have come apart. It may have broke. It may have shattered. The crew is telling Jeremy Clements to kill the motor. It is a left front brake rotor issue. The rotor is gone now, the team is telling driver Jeremy Clements. A disappointing run for these guys after they won the guitar in Nashville. This is their next race back and looking for better things, obviously.
Other problems on the racetrack. The 32 of Mike Lynette also on the access road about to come onto pit road.
Looks like that may be a left front tire gone down. It is a left front flat tire on Michael Lynette. You know, we saw a lot of tire problems at Pocono with a left front tire. This is actually the exact same tire that Hoosier brought here that they ran at Pocono, and it looks like a left front flat tire for Michael Annette.
So he will come onto pit road right now. We've completed 17 laps. We're on lap 18. You see the 21 also on pit road. That's Jeremy Petty just in front of that 32. And they've got the hood up on that car. Ray Dunlap, what's going on down there on pit road?
Well, I wanted to add real quick on the 21, Jeremy Petty. Today is actually his 25th birthday, so trying to celebrate there. But they have an ignition problem of some kind, or they feel like maybe some of the spark plug wires have come off. So they're taking a look under the hood there. And you're right, it was a left front flat on the TMC race car of the 32. They're on their way back to the racetrack.
see Jeremy Clements, number three, get pushed behind the wall. So a short night for Jeremy Clements after coming off of such a great finish just 2-3 weeks ago when he won at Nashville. Josh Wise still dominating over the field right now. He's got 2.3 seconds over Justin Allgaier, who's running second. Then it's Mark Mitchell. And the six of Dexter Bean, Michael McDowell, rounding out your top five. Tomorrow, the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series wakes the ground here at Gateway International Speedway. Travis Quaffle, Ron Hornaday, and Johnny Benson have kept point leader Mike Skinner out of victory lane in the last three races. Well, can they do it again? Skinner's never led a lap here at this racetrack. The NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series live tomorrow, 5 p.m. Eastern, 2 p.m. Pacific, only on Speed. And you see smoke rolling out from underneath that number five. And that is Brian Keselowski. He has blown the left front tire, and so we're under our first caution.
Another left front tire problem. We saw Michael Annette have one. Now Brian Keselowski, and he made some contact with the outside wall. You can see the front right front fender wrinkled a little bit. Here you can see pancake the right side of that Lucas Oil Chevrolet. So tough break for Brian Keselowski.
Yeah, good. Phil, you know, we saw issues with the left front tires, and everybody kept saying, well, is camber the issue? Are we running too much camber at a racetrack that's so flat like this?
Well, it's a combination of several things. Number one, it's camber. It's camber gain, how much as your car travels, how much camber actually is added to the wheel. Mm-hmm. And then also, you can see right there, there's a contact. The left front tire obviously already flat. Brian goes up and makes some contact in the turn one wall there. And also, you know, lack of air pressure. So here comes Michael McDowell on pit road a little bit early right here. He may want to take a look at that left front tire.
He was running fifth. Mark Mitchell just in front of him when this caution came out. And so Michael McDowell making his way onto pit road. Maybe some adjustments that Patrick Donahue wants to make to that number two. And so they bring him onto pit road to do just that. Jim Tredo. Let's go to Ray.
Yeah, I'll try this one, Rick, because they're going to take a half a pound of air pressure out of the left sides, put four tires on this gun. Also going to pull a piece of tape off. They felt like the engine temperature was just a little bit too hot. Seems to me maybe just a little bit early for tires here, but Patrick said he wasn't happy with the handle on the race car. So they're going to put four tires on this Make-A-Wish Charger, put them back out to the racetrack.
Guys, Aaron Crocker is in, as well as the 11 of Brian Silas. They're pitting together down here at the head of the pit road. I checked with Randy Seals, the crew chief on Aaron Crocker's cars. They're putting on right side tires, now lefts. Four tire changes down here for both Crocker and Silas. Crocker had a small miss in the engine that cleared itself within a half lap. Eerily similar to the last time she had issues with ignitions. Silas, no real changes, just four tires and fuel for Silas as Crocker beats him out.
You hear Silas killing the engine when they dropped it from the jack, and so had to refire that car before he got out on the racetrack.
A little bit early for pit stops here. Only 23 laps, actually 24 laps, and these guys are on pit road putting tires on.
Josh White stayed out on the racetrack, as did the 23 of Josh Krug, running right behind him, but it's the six of Dexter Bean that scored in second. And welcome back to Gateway. Again, we are just to the east of St. Louis in Madison, Illinois, just across the border. Frank Kimmel, when he comes back, when he came back out on the racetrack, he was scored in the 17th position. We take a look at his lead over McDowell the past five races after Kentucky, 145-point lead. So a big point lead there. And then Pocono, the problems for Kimmel, dropped that point lead to just 20.
Yeah, Frank got involved in an accident there, but that really necessitated him buying this very car right here that Ray was talking about early on from the Roush Fenway team, and Robbie Reiser in particular. This obviously is one of Matt Kenseth's old cars. As you can see, the car is still painted right, like it was when it was in the DeWalt colors. And Frank Kimmel, ever since he got this car, he has been really good. Third at Nashville, you can see right there, won Milwaukee. Also sandwiched a win at Springfield on the dirt. involved in the middle of that, not in this car. But Ray, Frank Kimmel loves this race car, doesn't he?
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, it's such a different animal. He said this thing turns through the corner so much better than any of the other cars that they had for speedway type racing. He pitted there on lap 23. They raised the track bar just a little bit and put four tires on it. I think anytime you see that two car come down pit road, you'll see the 46 come with them.
Strategy taking place there. The 98 of Aaron Crocker will restart just in front of Frank Kimmel. Again, out in front of the field, it is Josh Wise, Dexter Bean, Dominic Cassola, Philip Magilt, and Justin Marks. They're your top five as we are still under the yellow condition. They're continuing to clean up the racetrack, and I believe this will be the signal for one to go.
We're going to get one to go here. Let's see if we can make contact with Frank Kimmel. Hey, Frank Kimmel, Phil Parsons, can you hear me?
Got you, Phil.
How is that port forward so far there, Frank?
Not too bad, Phil. We got a lot of traffic there at the beginning, trying to be a little careful. Came down pit road there, put on a set of tires, and we'll see. Try to make it a little bit better, a little bit too tight, middle out right now, but Sport Fusion's a pretty good car. We'll try to get to the end.
We've already seen a couple left front tires go down, one on Michael Annette and one on Brian Keselowski. Any concern about that left front?
Sure, that's why we decided to pit, just to make sure we didn't have that problem. Points racing, you know all about that, babe.
All right, buddy, get one to go, about a half lap till the green. Make that way, make your way to the front, bud.
Good, Phil, thanks.
Right behind him, that's the number 11 of Brian Silas, riding along with him. He's currently in the 17th position. Again, he started this race 22nd. Stuart, Florida native.
Think about the top nine cars right now in the running order stayed on the racetrack. Michael McDowell will restart this race in 10th, and he was obviously one of the cars that came down pit road, put tires on.
Yet only 24 cars now on the lead lap. The last car on the lead lap as we get ready to restart is Brian Keselowski in the number 5. And he had left front tire issues as well. Green flag back in the air. We're back to racing.
Dexter Bean is all over the back of that 22 of Josh Wise. Looks to the inside for just a moment. Not able to make anything happen yet.
The 23 of Josh Krug just behind them, and he restarted on the inside of the 22. He's a lap down. I talked to Josh after practice. He said, well, he goes, here's the issue. My car's a little bit tight in the corner, actually in 1 and 2. It's a little tight in 3 and 4. Actually, it's tight on the straightaway. And I said, that's not a good thing, right? He goes, no, we're having problems. So they were fighting a tight issue. And a lot of drivers were saying they almost had to be a little bit loose in 3 and 4 for their car to be good in 1 and 2.
Yeah, very typical because of the tighter radius of that corner down in 1 and 2. It's banked a little bit more, about 2 degrees more than 3 and 4, but a lot tighter radius. And that is very typical of this racetrack. You need to be free down at 3 and 4 so you can be good, especially up off of 2.
It's the battle for 1 and 2. A guy moving up through the field, we talked about him earlier, was Colin Brown in that number 99.
Hey, look at that 48 car, though. Look to the inside. That's Carl Long. He's given that 48 car a good ride. Carl is a great race car driver. We've seen him run some Busch races over the years, even cup races and a few truck races. But he's given that 48 car a good ride here.
Looking to the inside of Colin Brown now. Colin Brown, again, a Roush Fenway development driver. And just behind him, Carl Long in that number 48.
Both of these guys stayed on the racetrack on this most recent caution flag.
And only one caution has come out here. We've completed 32 laps of racing. The top 10, Josh Wise, Dexter Bean, Dominic Cassola, Justin Marks, Philip Magilt, and they're your top 5. And it's Colin Brown in that number 99. Carl Long in the 48 just behind him. Patrick Shelter in the 60 is running 8th. Michael McDowell in 9th. And rounding out the top 10, the 87 of Andy Lally.
We have 3 road racers right now up in the top 10 with Justin Marks running 4th, Michael McDowell 9th, and Andy Lally running 10th. So the road racers are very well represented here at Gateway.
Yeah, and you mentioned the fact that, you know, they may have a little bit of an advantage in the fact that in road racing you shift a lot more.
Yeah, you really do, and they're used to that, certainly. And I know I was talking to Michael McDowell, and I mentioned a few minutes ago, as we see Patrick Shelton move to the inside of Carl Long. And look at Michael McDowell, going to make it three wide, getting in three.
So Shelton's going to drop back just a bit. Carl Long in front of him, and we hear the caution has come out once again. You see the smoke and the problems on the backstretch.
That's the 98 right there of Aaron Crocker.
Aaron Crocker, Gabby DiCarlo are on board on that great clip. Chevrolet also involved. Jason Edleski in the 75 got turned around.
See a lot of damage to that 98 car right there of Aaron Crocker. He leads the ARCA Remax Super Speedway Challenge coming in here. He has a pretty comfortable lead right now, but a lot of damage to that Evernham Dodge.
So the second caution of the night coming out on lap 35. We take a look back at why this caution came out.
She's going to try to make her way to pit road. Here it is right here. Looked like Aaron might have made just a slight bit of contact with the 75 of Jason Hedleski, and when she did, then Gabby DiCarlo had nowhere to go. That impeded Aaron's progress. Gabby ran in the back of her. Watch this right here.
Yeah, the contact was actually, and I can't make out the number on that.
That was, I think that was the 75 of Jason Hedleski, was it not?
No, Jason was over here, spun out on the side to the left of us. So these two cars got involved, but I'm going to try to figure out who got into the back of the 98 of Aaron Crocker.
Probably going to be somebody that comes down pit road with some damage. Yeah, how about that 25 car?
It was
possibly
the 25. That's exactly who it was. It was the 25 of Ryan Fisher that got into the back of the 98. You see all the damage to the front end as they come onto pit road.
It's the Venturini Motorsports car. Ryan Fisher making his ARCA Remax debut.
So there were four cars involved in this one, the 98, the 90, the 75, and the 25. And Aaron Crocker will have the damage to the back end of that car. See where that 25 got into the back of the 98, got her turned around. And as she was turned around, the 90 of Gabby DiCarlo with nowhere to go got involved in that one as well.
There's Gabby DiCarlo right there, the Great Clips Chevrolet. Gabby had a problem qualifying, went out to qualify, and the car missed very, very badly. I talked to her car owner as we see our leaders on pit road right now.
Here they come. They're going to be completing the 36th lap of this race. Again, 120 scheduled for 150 miles on this mile and a quarter racetrack. And Josh Wise and Dexter Bean making their way down pit road to their pit stalls. Peeling off first, the six of Dexter Bean. Josh Wise will be all the way down at the end. Jim?
Both the leaders complaining of a little bit tight in the center. Josh Wise neutral in turns three and four. His new crew chief, Wayne Carroll, has made the call to make four tire change. Hoosier radio's going on. A track bar adjustment and a little bit of air pressure going down just a pound or less of air on Josh Wise's Toyota. Again, this is the very same car Josh Wise drove last time he was in the ARCA Remax Series, but he hasn't won a pole before. We'll see if he makes that into magic into victory here as he's first one off pit road.
Colin Brown also coming off of pit road now as they've made some adjustments there, right?
Yeah, just air pressure adjustments on that right front and the right rear on that number 99 car. He's saying he's a little bit tight rolling through the corners, but he said one and two's not too bad, but actually three and four is worse, which you would think would be just the opposite. But Colin Brown trying to do a little bit of learning here, making air pressure adjustments from Jeff Campy on the right side.
So our second caution of the night has come out at Gateway. We're underway with the Gateway ARCA 150. We'll be back with more Green Flag Racing. FoxSports.com and SpeedTV.com form the most powerful online team in NASCAR. For breaking news, in-depth analysis, detailed driver stats, and more, log on to SpeedTV.com right now. Track cleanup continuing from our most recent caution. Again, a four-car pileup. Aaron Crocker, Gabby DiCarlo, 75 of Jason Hedleski, and that 25 driven by Ryan Fisher, all involved. And as most of the field came down pit road, it was the one of Dominic Cassola who stayed out on the racetrack. He and the 48 of Carl Long have now moved into the first and second positions. Jim Tredo.
Guys, one very good reason why Dominic Cassola is doing so well here is Andy Belmont has asked, and he got the cooperation of Chad McCombie. Chad started the year racing for Andy Belmont and won at Pocono, actually for the car with the Petty Enterprises team. So what they did is Chad McCombie agreed, as he's sitting on the pit box, you can see here with Andy Belmont, for the first hour of practice today, it was Chad McCombie in this one car. It was not Dominic Cassola. So the confidence they have in the car, I asked Chad a moment ago, how close was the car before and after you were in it? He said the car was close. I just had to give Dominic the the confidence, really, to get this car fast. So he spent a one full hour in this car. So McCombie trying to help out Andy Belmont, his buddy here on the pit box, watching intently, also trying to make sure this car is fast, as Dominic Cassola in his first season of racing here hasn't been this strong all season today.
They really had a great qualifying run. He parlayed that limited amount of practice time into a sixth place qualifying effort. So good job by Dominic Cassola, and thanks to Chad McCombie for helping out. And that's actually, Chad won two races this year in the ARCA Remax Series. In addition to that Pocono win, he won at Nashville the first time around.
It was a big weekend for him at Pocono, getting to get his first ride in a Cup Series car. And he started that off with the ARCA Remax Series win at that racetrack. We see on the inside of row number one, the 32 of Michael Annette. We talked about that being a force to be reckoned with tonight, but a left front tire going down for Michael Annette early on in this race relegated him to a lap down position. So he's fighting to get back on the lead lap. He'll restart on the inside of row number one. If he's able to get in front of that number one and stay there until a caution comes out, then he would be able to gain that lap back. Green flag back in the air.
This is a good opportunity for Michael Annette to get that lap back. He has a little fresh tires, then does Dominic Cassola in that one car. Dominic has not stopped yet this entire race.
Dominic with a great restart. He was able to jump out to two car length lead over Michael Annette. Now Annette will have to try to get by him. And look at Michael McDowell trying to make the pass early on the 48 of Carl Long.
Yeah, Michael McDowell would love to get up there, lead this race, get 5 bonus points, and inch a little bit closer to Frank Kimmel.
In the big picture, looking for a championship, someone other than Kimmel. Other than named Kimmel in the ARCA Remax Series winning in this century.
It's about a decade.
Nobody else has done it.
It's about a decade for Frank Kimmel.
Kimmel has won since 2000, and he had a win before that. So 8 championships for Frank Kimmel in the ARCA Remax Series. And his closest competitor right now running in the third spot, and that's Michael McDowell.
Yeah, keep an eye on that 40 car right behind Michael McDowell. That's Brian Clausen. Brian has had a terrific season. He's only raced 4 times in the ARCA Remax Series. 2 runner-up finishes, a 5th and then a 14th. So great job by Ganassi development driver Brian Clausen.
Yeah, that most recent second came at Nashville. As we look at Michael Annette again trying to get by Dominic Cassola, that's not for position, but it is for the opportunity of Michael Annette to be back on the lead lap. He is working diligently to take that position away, as Michael McDowell has taken 2nd away from Carl Long.
Carl's going to fight back on the outside. Does a pretty good job hanging in there. Brian Clausen's also going to get by the 48 of Carl Long. Remember, no lucky dog in the ARCA Remax Series. So if you're going to get your lap back, you're going to have to earn it. That's what Michael Annette is done right now. If the caution were to come out, he would be able to circulate all the way around the racetrack and get that lap back. He would restart on the tail end of the lead lap.
So another guy who stayed out on this most recent caution is that 46 of Frank Kimmel. And look at him making the move now as he goes to the outside of Carl Long here at Gateway.
Yeah, I'm sure brother and crew chief Bill Kimmel adjusted on that 46 car a little bit on his pit stop. Frank stopped back on the lap number 24 caution. He's had a chance to adjust on that car, stayed on this out on this most recent round of pit stops. But they only ran about 10 more laps than did the cars that pitted on this most recent caution flag.
And again, we expected the pit window to be between 70 and 75 laps. Dominic Cassola still on that strategy right now, as we've completed 44, coming up on 45 laps of racing. And Dominic Cassola has not left the racetrack yet as far as coming on the pit road.
Dominic Cassola is really doing a good job on those older tires. We know Michael McDowell has newer tires right there. You can see right there, last lap he was almost a mile an hour faster than Dominic Cassola. But again, fresher tires.
So now again, Michael Annette is in front of Dominic Cassola. If a caution were to come out, Michael Annette would be able to go all the way around the racetrack, tack onto the back of the field, so he would be back on the lead lap. Actually, he is officially on the lead lap right now because he's in front of the number one Dominic Cassola is leading this race in the number one. Right behind him is the two of Michael McDowell running second, then Brian Clausen in third in the 40.
Yeah, essentially, as you see Michael McDowell try to close up on the back through the center of the corner of Dominic Cassola. He would be able to, Michael's going to move to the inside, got a good run off of turn number four, going to move to the inside. Going to try to beat him down at turn number one before the downshift.
He didn't make it past the start finish line in front of Dominic Cassola, but now he's gotten by him. This is where he wants to lead that lap, get the five bonus points, and again continue to chip away on that lead that Frank Kimmel has.
And right now Michael Annette says, come on, caution flag, please come out. I see that two car coming up behind me. I know he's strong. I need to get that caution now to get my lap back.
Came out of turn number four across the start finish line. It is Michael McDowell in front of the field here at Gateway. There's top five. We've completed 50 laps here in the Gateway ARCA 150. We're scheduled to go 120 laps, so closing in on the halfway point. Frank Kimmel trying to take away a position from the one of Dominic Cassola. That would be for third. Brian Clausen running in second, and out in front of the field is Michael McDowell.
Frank looks to the outside, going to allow Mark Mitchell to close up a little bit on the bottom. We saw Frank make passes on the outside earlier. Frank has a pretty good race car right now.
Mark Mitchell in that number four just behind Frank Kimmel. Been riding on board with Mark. Good view of that number 46 of Frank Kimmel.
Nice run through the center of the corner for Frank that time. Not quite able to pull up beside Dominic Cassola, but Mark Mitchell's going to pull up beside Frank, or try to on the inside.
Good run for Mark Mitchell coming out of that turn.
Frank said, I'm not going to wait for you. I'm going to go to the high side, maybe try to get by Dominic Cassola.
Mark Mitchell looks to the inside. Kimmel on the outside, three wide. Kimmel's going to have to check up because the five, Ryan Keselowski up.
Oh,
right behind him. And he slides him. Oh, very close to hitting Frank Kimmel. There was Dexter Bean. Mark Mitchell involved in this one. You see the four. That's Dexter Bean in the six up top. And it looked as though there was a little more contact there as they were trying to go through between these cars that were wrecked on the racetrack.
A lot of damage to that six car, Dexter Bean.
That's Mark Mitchell there we're looking at.
So close to Frank Kimmel.
Oh,
I mean, Frank just
goodness.
About got caught getting in number three there as they slid up the racetrack. Philip Magilton got a piece of that.
Also involved. So our third caution of the night has come out. The four, the six.
The 47, we know for sure. A lot of damage to that four car, Mark Mitchell. There's Dexter Bean. You see the window net down. Tough, tough luck for these guys.
Dexter Bean got clipped and slid around, and at the time Frank Kimmel was running the high line and he was just above that six as it got turned around and it almost clipped that 46 of Kimmel.
Yeah, well, you know, we saw a three wide situation there going down towards turn number three, then we had some cars back off, but three wide here at Pocono doesn't work that well.
Or here at Gateway.
Or Gateway, either one. But you can do it at Pocono.
We talk about Pocono and this racetrack a lot as far as the similarities. And it's just it's a difficult situation here. You cannot go three wide on this racetrack. Ray Dunlap.
There's a good bit of damage here to the Aragon Dodge Charger, and these guys are trying to assess the damage and figure out what all they need to do. On the front here, you can see lower is almost completely coming out of the front end. And these guys discussing about what happened on the racetrack there, man, a three wide situation, pretty hard to get away from for sure. But Mark Mitchell had made a bunch of adjustments onto this car earlier on the first round of pit stops. He was tight at both ends of the racetrack and it was really coming back to him. He had worked his way back up through the field, but they've got a good bit of work to do here to get this thing back race ready.
So the damage on the number four, they're trying to work on that to see if they can get him back on the racetrack. One driver who's not going to be running anymore in this is Dexter Bean. We see him out of the number six, and so Dexter Bean's night is done. Dexter coming into this race third in the point standings.
Yeah, he had an outside shot at possibly gaining on Frank Kimmel and Michael McDowell if something would have gone wrong to either one of those guys, but it doesn't look like it's going to happen. See, Frank's going to go by on the apron of the racetrack to try to avoid that accident site over there. A lot of debris, obviously, up on the racetrack.
Take another look at it. We just caught a glimpse of it as it was happening. Again, there's Kimmel on the high side. Involved in this is the four and the six. The six goes sliding up. It's so close to Kimmel right there.
Unbelievable. Just mere inches between the six of Dexter Bean and the 46 of Frank Kimmel.
We saw the 21 also sliding through that. That was Jeremy Petty.
Yeah, I think they were running three wide. They were rapidly approaching Jeremy Petty. Right there, remember, Frank Kimmel has already backed off, and really the four of Mark Mitchell is sideways completely by the time he gets down into turn number three, makes contact with the six of Dexter, and Dexter really makes some hard contact with the outside wall.
Yeah, we saw the rear end moving around there in that six as he hits the wall, so you know that that's the end of his night. Look at how close this is to Frank Kimmel right there. I mean, that's, if there wasn't contact, that was centimeters. Yeah.
And there's the point lead. If something happens to Frank Kimmel right there and Michael McDowell goes on to finish this race, watch this now.
Right along.
Looks like Dexter Bean was going to drive down to the inside.
And it's not over, Phil.
Yeah.
He slides down the racetrack and, oh, he gets clipped.
That's where Philip Magilton got the damage on the right side of his Ford.
So that number four back on pit road. They're going to continue to do work on it until they can get it at least good enough to go out and make minimum speed. And Mark Mitchell was obviously making a lot faster than that on the racetrack because he qualified second in this race. See, pit road is still closed. That's a sign that lets them know that they're not allowed onto pit road yet. It has not been opened yet. We're seeing them taking the access road to avoid the racetrack right now, where there's a lot of debris still on the racetrack. Again, Michael McDowell's out in front.
That's why the one of Dominic Cassola has not made his pit stop yet. Remember, we're 55, 56 laps into this race. Dominic Cassola has not made a pit stop yet. He will make a pit stop on this caution flag as soon as pit road opens. If he pitted right now before pit road is open, then he would have to restart from the tail end of the longest line, and that would be too steep a penalty to pay.
And again, a fuel issue is not a problem for Dominic Cassola, because we would expect them to be able to go at least 75 laps on fuel. We've only completed 56 laps up to this point. Looking back from Brian Silas's number 11.
It's been a little bit over 30 laps since Michael McDowell came to pit road and Brian Clausen. They pitted on lap number 24. We've just completed 56 laps. A number of those laps have been run under caution. This caution flag and the previous caution flag were where the rest of the field came down pit road.
And we see the green flag now going up, indicating that pit road is open. So now they can make their way onto pit road if they would like. It looked as though Brian Clausen had ducked onto the access road to make his way onto pit road. Dominic Cassola as well in that number one.
Michael McDowell will stay out on the racetrack. Frank Kimmel, our point leader, is on pit road.
Quite a few other cars also following him onto pit road. So Michael McDowell and the 84 of Norm Benning stay out on the racetrack. Norm not actually on the lead lap. Let's go down pit road and Ray Dunlap.
Well, Frank Kimmel has brought his race car back in. They feel like they need to continue to make air pressure adjustments here. He is just a little bit too tight in the corners. And, you know, normally we hear Frank Kimmel always saying that he's tight, but this new race car has been a lot better as far as turning through the corners. We've actually heard him say loose a few times in previous races, but tonight you pretty much figured they'd be saying tight whenever you come to Gateway. That's normally the situation. They made air pressure adjustments on the right side for that green heck fusion.
Dominic Cassola also onto pit road.
Yeah, Andy Belmont's guy is going to make adjustments to that car. Four tires put on it. See, Josh Wise was still on pit road as Dominic Cassola leaves. There's the 18 right there of Billy Leslie. And the 60 of Patrick Shelton.
Following him off of pit road. So again, three cautions have taken place here at Gateway. We'll be back with more green flag racing after this. Speed's coverage of the ARCA RE/MAX series from Gateway is brought to you by Just for Men. Stay in the game with Just for Men hair color. Stay in the race. That's exactly what Brian Silas is doing, as well as Frank Kimmel and Michael McDowell staying in this race. And it was a close one, I tell you what, for Frank Kimmel moments ago.
Unbelievably close. Let's take a look at really what started this coming off turn number two. There's Frank Kimmel right there, the Ford Fusion. Our point leader and eight-time series champion. Watch this now. This is coming off turn two. This is when they start to go three wide. But watch Frank Kimmel. There's not a whole lot of room between the one of Dominic Gasola. Dominic kind of drifts up a little bit. Frank's going to drift up also. Just about makes contact, maybe even slight contact with the outside wall right before the opening where the trucks drive across the racetrack. Now Frank gets down there. He's trying to determine what to do behind the five of Brian Keselowski. Backs off, lets those guys go in there and crash, drives around the outside of him, almost gets clipped, and no damage.
Not a scratch. 46. Not a scratch. Can Michael McDowell making sure he stays out of any issues or trouble? Right, Ray?
Well, we've hit the halfway point, Rick, right here as we just went by lap 60. So I want to hear from Patrick Donahue. Why not pit that time? I figured you'd be in every time you could to get tires.
Well, we finally got our track position, and the car's pretty good. We're a little down on motor, but I hate to get back there in traffic, get wrecked, tear something up. I mean, right now we're about 10 laps. We're making it on fuel to the end. So we get a little bit more caution, we might not come at all. But Mike's doing real good, and I just want to keep the thing out front. And there'll be more cautions. We'll get some tires on here in another 20 or 30 laps. We'll be fine.
Okay. All right. Well, that's interesting strategy, guys. You know, we heard a lot of these guys talking earlier today about the fact that you'd want to try to put tires on every chance you get an opportunity to, but they didn't seem to fall off a whole lot throughout the course of a run here. So interesting strategies. Kimmel came down pit road, made adjustments to get his car better, and McDowell decided to keep the track position.
He likes that track position, Ray, and clean racetrack.
Just for mid-race summary, after we've crossed the halfway point, Michael McDowell out in front. That's 5 bonus points for him. Our average speed, just over 86 miles an hour. 3 cautions for 20 laps up to this point. And that's something that Patrick Donahue is going to be watching, the caution laps. He mentioned the possibility of being able to stay out until the end of this race. Green flag back in the air. We are back to racing at Gateway International Raceway. Justin Marks running second in the number 65. Then it's right behind him, the 14 of Brett Rowe. Stayed out onto the racetrack. Cullen Brown, and the 40 of Brian Clausen are top 5.
Heavy, heavy traffic. Again, another 3 wide situation going down in turn number 3 again.
And the last time we were in a 3 wide situation, one guy is not in his race car anymore. And as a matter of fact, he's standing by with Jim Prado.
Dexter Bean is down here running up off at the lead during this race. Dexter, what did happen on that 3 wide, 4 wide?
I don't know. There's a few lap cars in the mix of things, and I think just a combination of some slow lap cars, and you know, you got 3 fast cars that are yourself to the front, and we made it, ended up getting 3 wide somehow, I think, and I was in the middle and found a hole, and I thought I made it, but I guess I got piled somehow, and just unfortunate.
Ryan Fisher in the 25 rolls down the back stretch. The caution has come out. Debris all over the racetrack.
Incredible. While we were talking to Dexter Bean there, that can happen. We saw that happen before in the truck series where somebody got forced into the outside wall and actually got up on their side. I believe it was Rick Crawford a few years ago.
Bobby Hamilton also.
Patrick Shelter involved. There's a 22-hour pole sitter. Josh Wise got a piece of that.
4th caution coming out and a magnificent crash here by the 25. Ryan Fisher in that car for the first time this year. Again, that's a Venturini owned race car.
Getting report, you see Michael McDowell stopping over there in turn 1 and 2. ARCA Remax officials will put this race under red right now so they can attend to Ryan Fisher in the 25 car as well as clean up all the debris. It's all over the backstretch.
So the red flag comes out. We've completed 63 laps. Red flag coming out on lap 64. Again, the safety crews making their way onto the backstretch. You see Josh Wise on that access road to pit road, and he is going to come to a stop as well. I'm sure hearing over his radio that the red flag has come out. Field stopping in turns 1 and 2 right now.
See the window, the roof flat up on the 22 of Josh Wise. So
damage to the right side of that car. Phil, we just caught a glimpse of that as we were talking with Dexter Bean. It was in the right side of your screen. Dexter Bean was out of the race because of the caution that had happened previously. He and Mark Mitchell got into each other in turn three. Philip Magilton caught a little bit of that accident. And then after they had cleared the racetrack and had been racing for just a few laps, it was another problem between the 25 of Ryan Fisher and the 60 of Patrick Sheltra and the 22 of Josh Wise.
Josh is going to go ahead and make his way to pit road. He will not be able to stop and do any work on pit road during the red flag conditions.
Taking a look at Ryan Fisher, little woozy after that ride, and oh, what a ride it was. That car rolling down the backstretch, but a great sign to see Ryan Fisher out talking, and looks as though he's going to climb out under his own power.
Yeah, it's great to see right there. A pretty memorable first start in the ARCA Remax series for Ryan Fisher.
Yeah. You hear the crowd applauding as they see Ryan Fisher climbing out of that car. They'll put him in the back of the ambulance, take him to the infield care center. Let's take another look at what took place here.
See, Ryan's on the outside following Billy Leslie. There's Patrick Sheltra. The 8-11 of Brian Silas makes contact. Wow!
Up into the wall. Patrick Sheltra hits him, slides him up into the wall, and then the rolls begin.
It looked like the 25 of Ryan Fisher just launched over the 60 of Patrick Sheltra. You see that car slid for a little bit right on the roof, right over top of the driver, but these cars are so well built. Here's another view. You see the 60 get sideways.
60 sideways and then into the 25. Like you mentioned, Phil, launched.
Yeah, from that first view, it looked like Brian Silas turned down, but once Patrick Sheltra caught his car from being sideways, he actually drifted up the racetrack and made contact with Brian Silas.
Ride along with Brian Silas here and see the view he had of this one.
Saw Brian got out of the throttle to try to give him room. He's the one that made contact with a 22 of Josh Wise. Josh Wise, Brian did a good job of keeping his car straight.
And again, this is a look real time now. Sheltra's going to go to the right. That was Ryan Fisher in that 25. And again, Fisher is out of that car. They're going to try to put it on the rollback. And so there will be a little cleanup from Gateway International Raceway. A magnificent accident taking place on the backstretch. They'll clean it up. We'll go back to racing when we come back. Welcome back. The safety crew's now taking a look at the catch fence along the backstretch. And the reason for that is we've just had our fourth caution of the night, and the damage that has taken place there was from the 25 driven tonight by Ryan Fisher. And we take a look from behind. The 60 is going to come across, hit the 25, and look at him into that catch fence. Tore the right wheel completely off of the race car.
Yeah, but that catch fence did its job. I mean, it put that car back down, did not let it go outside the racetrack. That's what that catch fence is for. Yeah, it bent a little bit, and maybe that bit some of those poles, but it did its job. You can see all the damage to the right front. That's where the car hit the catch fence. It just ripped the right front wheel assembly completely off that car.
That's the damage to the 25 car. Again, tonight driven by Ryan Fisher. Now, the driver of this car was taken into the ambulance and into the infield care center, but he was able to get out of the car on his own. So that was a great sign. We'll wait to hear the results from the infield care center when he's able to get out of there, but a wild ride for Ryan Fisher.
That was a few moments ago when Ryan was able to climb out of the car on his own power. ARCA Remax officials right there with him.
Kind of catching his breath, it looked like. He's like, wow, did I just ride through what I felt?
I've never seen a wreck like I just had.
Yeah, very amazing. We see the workers still continuing there. Well, Sunday on Speed, step into the wind tunnel with Dave Despain. Don't miss the biggest names and the biggest opinions, well, and the biggest mouths all season long. This week's guest, John Force, 14-time champion. The NHRA. Wind Tunnel with Dave Despain, Sunday 9 p.m. Eastern, live on Speed. So as the safety crews continue to work on the catch fence and clean up the racetrack, we're under red flag conditions from Gateway International Raceway.
NASCAR's toughest roar through the Gateway City. This is huge.
Under the moonlight and under the lights here at Gateway International Raceway, the gateway to the west, and there's the damage that's been done to the catch fence on the backstretch of this racetrack. We're hearing from the officials that they are going to try to fix that catch fence as far as the fencing to make sure for the safety of the spectators that are on the backstretch. They want to make sure that nothing has the possibility of flying off of this racetrack or out of this racetrack as the race cars are going by. And we're under red flag condition. Now we've passed the halfway point. We've completed 63 laps. We're on lap 64 of 120. Michael McDowell is out in front of the field. Justin Marks second. Third, Brett Rowe. Fourth, Colin Brown. And fifth is the 40 of Brian Clausen. Josh Wise started this race on the pole and involved in this most recent accident, but he is parked on pit road. And I believe Jim Trado is caught up with the guy he's trying to get closer to, his crew chief, Jim.
And Wayne Carroll is anxiously awaiting Josh Wise when he's able to come down pit road, but I understand there may be some confusion there. The car rolled on the red. What's the story, Wayne?
Well, you know, the official over here in our box told us we could roll down pit road and stop here. And then we started rolling. They said, oh, no, stop, you know. So now they're kind of bickering back and forth up there trying to figure out what to do. Whatever happens, we'll just do the best we can, you know, get in here and try to get the car fixed. And
what did Josh and your spotter say about the car damage that you will have to address when he comes down pit road?
We don't think it's that bad. Josh thought he got hit pretty hard, but we looked at it on TV and a replay, and it looked like he just maybe got in the side of the car and the door. Steering wheel's still straight. Everything looks good, so we'll see.
Patrick Donahue said your setups were identical, but he gave you more of the credit for getting the cars dialed in. What's the reason, Wayne? What, you came to this team rather late in the season, I'd say. You're now overseeing the 22, but talk about the setups and how much you play a role in this Eddie Sharp Racing team.
They're very similar. You know, we come to the racetrack pretty close. We unload close together. His driver likes a little different thing than our driver does, you know. We go one way a little bit, he goes the other way. We try some different things. We share information back and forth and try to make the 2 and the 22 go fast.
They've been fast tonight, guys. Awaiting Josh Wise down on pit road is Wayne Carroll, the crew chief on that Toyota Camry.
Well, when you're talking about fast, obviously you've got to talk about the guy who's leading the race, and that's Michael McDowell. There's Patrick Donahue, his crew chief, that is calling all the shots from top the pit box. Get Michael McDowell out in front of this field.
It makes Patrick Donahue's strategy of staying out, staying in front of all the traffic, look like a pretty good strategy right now.
Yeah, especially that accident that took place again on the backstretch behind them.
Let's see if we can talk to Michael McDowell. Hey, Michael McDowell, Phil Parsons, can you hear me? Well, we're past halfway. You've got the lead, and it looks like they're trying to fix the fence. Ray Dunlap reported during our commercial break that Patrick said he has a plane to catch. He just as soon go ahead and stop this race now. What do you think?
Yeah, we were kidding there. Yeah, no, definitely. We got a good car tonight. We've been working on it a little bit. You know, we didn't qualify where we wanted to, but we knew we had a car that could race to the front. You know, we're just past halfway now, so we just got to keep on keeping this number 2 D-Line design car up front. When the pit stops kind of work out here in the next 30, 40 laps, we'll see where we're at, make a run at the end.
Yeah, Patrick said that you were really fairly close to your window on making it the rest of the way, but he said, we know there are going to be some more caution flags, so we'll probably get in and get some tires, and we'll be good to go to the end.
You know, it's tough to have the perfect strategy every time. So, you know, for us right now, we want to stay out front, kind of stay out of the mess and keep the track position. And when it gets closer to the end, we'll come in for that final stop.
I know you didn't have a view because you were up front of what happened back there, but I know when you came back around the racetrack, I don't know that you ever even went back through there. So we had a pretty heck of a wreck over here with a 25 of Ryan Fisher.
Yeah, they're telling me about it. I hope everybody's okay. Well, it sounds like they are. You know, I didn't get an opportunity to see it, but the good news is I go home and watch Speed Channel and get the highlights on Speed Report.
Well, that's what we like to hear, buddy. Great run so far. Keep it going.
Thanks, guys.
Michael McDowell looking for his third win of the 2007 season. He's already grabbed a couple wins here as he is going for his first championship in the ARCA RE/MAX Series, trying to upset 8-time series champion Frank Kimmel. McDowell finding victory lane at Kentucky and then right again followed that up with his Pocono win. And we're hearing that Ryan Fisher is out of the infield care center and with Ray Dunlap.
Yeah, he sure is, and we're hoping we can show him a replay here shortly. But, Ryan, what an unbelievable ride. Can you tell us what it was like inside the race car?
Sky ground. That's what it was. Sparks everywhere. I'm all right. My knee's a little sore. Face got a little cut on it. But other than that, I'm all right, I think.
I think if you get a chance to look at this replay, you will be amazed. It was really quite a crazy ride.
That's what I hear from everybody else. All our members, Billy Venturini, yelling on the radio, well, that was about the worst wreck I've ever seen, so I'm all right, so that's a good thing.
Okay, take a look right here on the monitor. We'll show it to you, and this is just amazing as you get launched up from the beginning right here.
I remember every single bit of that. I don't remember how many times I flipped. Oh, there's three. There's a stand up, right up. I mean, yeah, that's wild, that's for sure. It's the worst wreck I've ever taken, but at least I'm still here, which is a good thing.
Tell me about the early part of the night here, though, and your experience here. This was your first race in the ARCA Remax Series.
Yeah, my debut. We just announced yesterday that we just signed with CJM Racing. I'm going under development for them, for their Busch deal and everything else. And I'm looking forward to the future. I mean, things like this happen, but that's racing, I guess. That's the way it is.
Well, the most important thing is you're standing here, you're okay, and they said make sure you tell mom at home everything's fine.
Again, that's Ryan Fisher, Surrey, British Columbia, his hometown, and it looks as though we might see a little bit of action here as they're getting ready to move the pace car back out.
He probably will not ever forget his first ARCA Remax race.
I don't know if I'll ever forget his first ARCA Remax Series race. We'll be right back with more.
Sunday from the California Speed.
Still red flag condition here at Gateway International Raceway as they have stopped action because of an accident on the backstretch. All of the participants that were involved in it have been checked out and released from the infield care center, but the safety crew still trying to bandage up the catch fence on the backstretch. And the reason why they are doing that is because of this. We take a look at what took place there on the backstretch. And again, this is the 60 of Patrick Shelton in the green car. We're going to look at that in a moment, but early on it was Brian Keselowski cutting a left front tire, getting into the wall.
Aaron Crocker got run into from behind by the 25 of Ryan Fisher.
Yep.
Also collected Debbie to Carlo. Michael McDowell takes the lead from the one of Dominic Cassola.
Dominic Cassola grabs the lead. And then another accident. Dexter Bean sliding around, almost getting into the back of the 46 of Frank Kimmel.
Mark Mitchell also involved in that accident, as well as the 47 of Philip Magilton.
Dexter Bean walked away from that one. This is why the catch fence needed repaired. Three times around goes Ryan Fisher.
You see that deck lid flipping around there, still held on by the tethers. And there's the ARCA Remax officials along with track officials making repairs to the catch fence.
They have walked away from that catch fence, and it looks as though the officials are making their way around the racetrack. The track has been blown off by the jet dryers as far as the debris that was left on it. So we would say within moments, they're going to be firing the cars back up and getting them started. Jim Trado.
I caught up with Sean Parker down in the Bruco development pits for Philip McJilton. He ran third last race, but this has been a whole different story. You were worried about the car having damage, but you're still sitting top 10, Sean. What is Philip saying on the radio?
Well, first of all, I'm glad to see Ryan's okay. That was a pretty wild crash back there, and glad to see everybody's okay. And I got him on a track position there a little bit, and I got to get it back for him. He's doing a great job. We got a little behind there on our strategy, so I'm debating now. We're pretty close to making it right now, but if we get a green-white checkered at the end, it's going to be very close. And six cars out, and we're racing in for points. And conservative or gamble for it? I don't know which way to go right now. Probably going to gamble for it.
That's why you get the big bucks. What are you thinking now? You said at the time of you pitting, you said you may be good to go the rest of the way.
Well, we need a few more caution laps, and we'll see how the time and the scoring shakes out, where we line up, who's behind us on the lead lap, and we probably can do it. It's hard to pass out there. Even though we got a really good car, I think I'm going to gamble for it. That's what we come here to do, and that's what we're going to do.
All right, guys, Sean Parker making the gamble with Philip and Shilton's car. He has some right side damage they're trying to take a peek at. The spotter could not get a good view on it, but does not seem to be hampering their efforts right now.
And we're hearing potential gamble there by Sean Parker in the 47. Wonder what Andy Lally will do. I mean, he's ran pretty well here for his first start.
Really been impressed with Andy Lally here in the last month or so. We talked about him running a couple Busch races in the Clorox number 47 for Wood Brothers JTG Racing. Had a good run going in Montreal, probably a top five finish, end up losing a gear. Then he finished in the top 10 at Watkins Glen in the Busch race against all the Nextel Cup drivers, and had a good top 10 his very first ever ARCA Remax race last week.
Right. At Milwaukee, he was able to come home with a 10th place finish. Colin Brown in that number 99, currently scored in the fourth position. So starting in 13th, he's moved up to fourth, and another impressive start for a young driver in this series.
We talked to Jeff Campy, his crew chief on this Roush development team right here, Roush Fenway, and he's very, very high on Colin Brown. He said, you know, real quick learner, was very fast. They tested up here, was very fast in the test, really caught on, and doing a terrific job here. He said, you know, we don't even know what our expectations are for this race. Yeah, we would love to finish in the top 10, but it's all about getting him track time. We know he's going to run a couple more races this year, and at 18 years old, we know he's going to be around for a long, long time.
Continuing on with our Rolex theme right now, the 65 of Justin Marks currently second, so he's right behind Michael McDowell when we go to restart this race.
So impressed last week at Milwaukee with Justin Marks. Frank Kimmel caught him. They raced extremely hard towards the last few laps, and Frank was able to get by Justin Marks, but Justin has absolutely nothing to be ashamed of. A great run for him. 2 weeks in a row, yep. Good runs for him. He finished fourth on the dirt at Springfield, and they came right back to Milwaukee and got a good top two finish,
yep.
Finished in second.
Career best finish a week ago at Milwaukee, coming home in second. And we see the yellow flag now being waved into the air, and they will start rolling around the racetrack once again here at Gateway. Ray Dunlap.
Well, let's hear from Bill Kimmel. He's crew chief, of course, for Frank. And wondering right now about strategies here. You guys pitted at lap 57, so I got to believe with a little bit of caution here, you might be able to go the distance without pitting again. What's the plan?
I'd like to see it go green the rest of the way. And, yeah, we don't have to come back in if that was the case. But the car is not good enough to win the race right now. It's a little bit tight on exit, so we'll have to keep working on it because we're not getting up there to the front three or four cars, but we'll try to make it a little better as the day goes on, as the night goes on. But if it stayed green, I think we do have enough gas to make it to the end.
Yep. All right, guys, that's kind of the situation down here. They can go the distance here, and we heard earlier we think the two cars going to be coming back in for tires late in the race, so we'll see how it plays out.
Brian Silas in that Shell Rotella T. Number 11 looks as though he's got a flat left front tire.
I have a feeling he's going to make a pit stop.
We're pretty sure about that. Josh Wise now in pit road, or in the pits. Jim.
Well, they're tightening the antenna. They're knocking down that roof flap. They're also banging out the right front fender. They just asked Josh if he had any flat tires. They're going to change four. The left front does look a bit down on pressure, but they again had a lot of time to talk about what they wanted to change. He came down pit road now, still undecided whether he's going to be sent to the longest line in the back or get back out of position. But four tire change is the call by Wayne Carroll on this Napa Toyota. Josh, pretty calm and cool behind the wheel, telling him what other changes he wants to make. Just a small air pressure adjustment. They're looking at the right front once again. Looking underneath it now, as again we mentioned, brakes were an issue. They checked things over. They've got some brake dusting in hand. Let's see if that plays a role as he's down in the way. But the tubing that goes from the front grill back to the brakes to keep them cool is now in pieces here on pit road.
As we can see, the 11 of Brian Silas come down pit road. Josh Wise will have to restart this race from the tail end of the longest line because he pitted before pit road was open. So
right.
he will be penalized by the ARCA official.
And he was already on pit road because he was involved in that accident with Ryan Fisher. And so he was on pit road thinking he was going to roll through onto pit road and maybe get some work done on the car. But the pit road was not open when he came onto the access road. And then he rolled during the red flag condition. But told to stop again, he did, and so when we went back to caution, he just continued on to pit road before it was actually open. We see also the 11 of Brian Silas now on pit road. Philip McGilton also involved in that number 47. He's making his way off of pit road now and back onto the racetrack.
See right there, the flag is out. Pit road is open. Obviously, the two of Michael McDowell stayed on the racetrack, so Patrick Donahue was elected to keep Michael out on the racetrack.
He will stay out. We've heard some of the other drivers that are going to stay out.
There's Carl Long right there giving that 48 car a good ride. He's going to make his way back out onto the racetrack. Carl, one of the cars on the lead lap right now. We're showing 19 cars right now on the lead lap.
Mike McDowell, Justin Marks, Brett Rowe, Colin Brown. Right along with Gabby DiCarlo in that number 90. Great clips Chevrolet.
Gabby's being shown one lap down. She's running right now with a 21st position. She caught a little piece of that accident over there with Aaron Crocker and Ryan Fisher when they got together. Also the 75 of Jason Hedleski, making his first start for Bob Shack Motorsports,
right,
was involved in that.
A little bit of damage to the right side of that 47 of Philip Magilton, Jim.
That's why they came down pit road, guys. The gambler Sean Parker said, you know what, if we put gas in here and check that right side, get some tape on it, he thinks a lot of guys will have to pit, so track position was not as critical, nor were tires. He came down for gas only and a patch on the right side tires for the SI Performance Ford for these guys.
So, no gamble. Gamble or no gamble? Well, we got to go no gamble on that one.
Well, he needed to take a look at the right side to make sure they didn't have any damage that was going to affect the car. You know, if the damage is in between the tires, behind the front tire, in front of the rear tire, then it probably would not have caused any problems at all. But might as well be on the safe side, and while you're in there, put double enough fuel in to know that you can make it to the end of the race.
Yellow lights go off, the flashing lights off of the pace car, meaning next time by we'll get the green flag. So again, we've had four cautions here. The most recent caution turned into a red flag condition as they had to clean the back stretch up, as well as fix the catch fence on the back stretch where Ryan Fisher was launched into. And then after three rolls down the back stretch, that one ended up on its three wheels. One of them was torn off. Ryan Fisher climbed out of that car, went to the infield care center, was released. And so we are about to go back to racing now. It's Michael McDowell in front of Justin Marks.
A little bit over a 23-minute red flag slowdown, but hats off to the track workers for getting that fence repaired that quickly.
Excellent job. We get the field now all in a line behind Michael McDowell. Aaron Crocker being scored the first car a lap down, so she will start on the inside of row number one. And again, a lap down car. They get to move to the inside of the racetrack. Those on the lead lap are on the outside for the restart. Two road race background drivers. In front of this field, Michael McDowell, Justin Marks.
I tell you, Brett Rowe is giving that 31W insulation car a great ride right now.
Green flag back in the air. We're back to racing at Gateway.
Aaron Crocker was not able to get in front of our leader. Michael McDowell will try to get back on the lead lap, on the tail end of the lead lap. Justin Marks able to clear the lap car of Aaron Crocker. Colin Brown was looking to the inside that time on the 14 of Brett Rowe, not quite able to make the move. There's Frank Kimmel on the outside, the 46. He's driven by the 40. You're actually trying to drive by Brian Clausen. That is a battle for the fifth spot.
Brian Clausen able to get the nose back out in front of that number 40. And again, Kimmel trying to make his way around the high side. So two separate lines here at Gateway, and Kimmel taking the outside line. He'll take that position away, and he moves into fifth.
Get by that 40 of Brian Clausen, not quite able to get it done on the backside. Brake is hanging tough on the outside.
Dangerous ground outside of Brian Clausen. Now it's a drag race to the start finish line. Again, this is a battle for fifth. Clausen still holding on to that position as Kimmel still on the outside. Now Dominic Casola on the inside of him. Justin Allgaier and this number 16 also moving up on the inside.
Frank not quite able to make it done. Looked like he was good through the corner. You see the one of Dominic Casola pull back up and actually drive by the 46 of Frank Kimmel, as well as Justin Allgaier.
So Kimmel continuing to stay on the high side of the racetrack.
Trying to work that high side to get by, as you see Justin Allgaier look to the inside of Dominic Casola, but trying to get to the high side to get by Brian Clausen, end up costing Frank a couple spots.
side by side. Justin Allgaier, Dominic Cassola, that's for position. Allgaier is going to take it away from Cassola.
Justin Allgaier takes over the sixth spot. Now Dominic Cassola going to fight back on the inside of the racetrack.
How about this side by side battle at Gateway? Dominic Cassola trying to chase down that 16 of Justin Allgaier now. Jim.
Guys, we talked about their strategy. He's kept the race lead and stayed out. They've only pitted once for tires and fuel. They did not even change the air pressures one bit. I just checked in with car owner Andy Belmont. He said, we're not coming back in again. We're good. This car is so perfect. We're just enjoying the race.
Boy, Justin Allgaier just drove around the outside of Colin Brown. And allowed the one of them and the Cassola to catch that 99 Roush Fenway car. Justin moves up to the fifth spot.
And dropping back, Frank Kimmel, very uncharacteristic here with only 48 laps of racing to go.
Yeah, really expected Frank to move towards the front. He's already back to the 10th position right now.
He was just battling for the fifth spot. And now Pete Sheppard in that number 39 looks to the inside of Kimmel.
Yeah, the 32 of Michael Annette. Remember, he was a lap down with that flat left front tire. He is back on the lead lap, back up into the top 10 right now.
Amazing. Pete Sheppard again looking to the inside. Pete Sheppard starting this race in the eighth position. He dropped back just a bit, but now battling with Kimmel for that 10th spot.
We heard Bill Kimmel tell us that that car is not good enough to win the race. It wasn't as good. You see the points as of now. Frank comes into this race with a 95-point cushion over Michael McDowell. If the race were to end right now, it would only be a 45-point lead for Frank Kimmel.
Big points night for Michael McDowell if he can continue to lead this field. And here Brett Rowe on the outside of Colin Brown in that number 99.
That is a battle for the fifth spot. Colin Brown going to try to get by that 14 of Brett Rowe, going to bring the one of Dominic Cassola with him. My big question is Michael McDowell going to stay out? I think by virtue of the fact that Patrick did not bring him in on this most recent caution, he's thinking about going the entire distance.
Can he make it? I'm going to let you call this because I think you've been pretty good in the past.
I don't know. It's a long way to go, I'll tell you that.
Long way to go. Ray, what do you think?
Well, Michael McDowell just came on the radio and said, I am not pushing this thing yet. You tell me when to go. I've got lots of brakes left and plenty to go. And Patrick Donahue said, don't worry about that. Do me a favor and just think about saving fuel.
That's a good idea. If you think you're going to be close, let's save a little bit. But it doesn't look like he's saving anything as far as the competition. 4.35 seconds, the difference between Dominic Cassola, Michael McDowell out in front, and Justin March running second. We'll be right back.
You say you want racing? Well, come and get it.
Whoa, look at this. This Labor Day weekend, the cars and stars of the American Le Mans Series turn Detroit's Belle Isle Park into a gear-grinding, tire-shredding, all-or-nothing Motor City battlefield. Will B2 Penske Porsches take yet another overall win, or can Audi bounce back? American Le Mans Series in Detroit, that's tomorrow, 9:30 p.m. Eastern, 6:30 p.m. Pacific, right here on Speed. We hope that they stay on all four tires during that race.
Yeah, we had one lose a tire here. And he got up in the catch fence, but right now Michael McDowell has it going all his way, but he last pitted on lap number 24.
Yeah.
This is a 120 lap race, 96 laps. I know we've had a lot of caution laps since then, but I'll tell you, that is getting great fuel mileage if he can make this thing the rest of the way.
Yeah, we've stopped three times since he stopped. We've been over probably 23 or 24 laps of caution since he stopped. But again, that's a long ways to go on one tank of fuel.
Yeah, well, we said the same thing about Jeremy Clements of Pocono. There's no way that he could go 135 miles on fuel. Well, he did. He went 134 and a half miles on fuel and then ran out coming off the final corner for the checkered flag.
He made it to the start-finish line, and he finished third in that race, but he did run out of gas.
Absolutely. But I know Patrick Donahue has to be biting all his fingers right now. 96 laps here on this mile and a quarter track. That's a long way to go. I know we've had a lot of caution laps, but boy, that could be a big gamble with a point championship possibly on the line.
Oh yeah, only 45 points behind Frank Kimmel right now as they run. Kimmel back in the 12th position now, so he's probably gained some spots or at least points on Kimmel since the last time we looked at the points battle. He really needs to start taking it easy on fuel.
Yeah, he's got a 6-second lead right now on our second place car of Justin Marks. There's a battle for second right there. Brian Clausen trying to take over second from Justin Marks.
Talked about the Rolex Series experience in some of these drivers. Michael McDowell, Justin Marks trying to hold on to second. Here comes Brian Clausen. Jim Tradel, what have you got down from pit road?
Well, I just tell you that the 40 car team was pretty excited, but there is a strategy being played out by Justin Marks in his pits. They said they're not coming down pit road. He came on lap 36. Crew chief car owner Robbie Benton said, we're staying out. We have a good race car. We wanted a long run. We've got it now. So we'll see how it plays out. As again, he had a long run last week at Milwaukee and got passed late in the going, just as he did now with Brian Clausen for a top three spot.
Oh, and problems. We're hearing car in the wall. That's Pete Sheppard in the 39. The caution comes back out. That's exactly what Michael McDowell and his crew chief wanted to see.
Yeah, I think Patrick Donahue has to keep Michael McDowell on the racetrack. You know, we're inside of 40 laps to go right now. It's very difficult to pass at this racetrack. I don't think Michael McDowell will want to give up the lead. I think they're just going to hope that this reduced speed under caution laps is going to give them enough extra fuel for this thing to get to the end.
Looks like another tire issue. That's the remnants. One of these Hoosier tires that obviously has come off of that 39. We see Patrick Donahue on top of that pit box talking to his crew members. Probably telling them, guys, just take a break. Relax. We're not coming.
There's a right front tire damage to Pete Sheppard. Pete was having a good run in this Rulo Brothers number 39 Ford. Have about 35 laps to go when the cars get back around here. That looks like the two of Michael McDowell is on the access road coming towards pit road.
They're going to bring him onto pit road. There are 18 cars on the lead lap. And so I guess Patrick Donahue has decided that with fresh tires and enough laps, he thinks he can get back to the front. Justin Marks also on pit road. Again, now you've got to look at big picture here with Michael McDowell and Frank Kimmel. Kimmel was going to be able to stay on the racetrack because of fuel.
But he was backing up.
But they came onto pit road because of adjustments. Ray Dunlap.
Well, it was the driver that made this call. Patrick Donahue said, let's stay out there. Frank's got an engine going down or some kind of a problem. We need the track position. And Michael McDowell said, no, give me the fresh tires. I can work my way back up and we can still win this thing. I think it's the right call. Let's do it. So they come in here and they put on four fresh tires. Jim?
Four tires is a call for Justin Marks and the Crocs Dodge. It turns out they were very close on fuel. If they didn't have this caution, they may have run out. So they did beat Michael McDowell in the pits. The team extremely happy with the four tires, no adjustments, and enough fuel to go to the finish.
You're seeing the 46 coming off of pit road. Moments ago, the hood was up on the 46 of Frank Kimmel. Again, that's Pete Sheppard getting into the wall. The reason for our fifth caution, his right front tire exploding on him, tearing up the right front fender of that car as well.
Yeah, that flat tire did more damage, I think, than even possibly hitting the wall. There's Frank Kimmel coming back out on the racetrack.
So as Frank Kimmel was dropping back, Michael McDowell, Patrick Donahue decided we think we can still win this with a stop. So they came onto pit road. Kimmel also came down. Let's find out how it shakes out.
What is tough? Tough is a Suzuki ATV. Quad fare, on the other hand, is easy. During Suzuki's quad fare, get low payments on select Suzuki ATVs, including the best-in-class King Quad, Quad Racer, or Quad Sport. Plus, when you buy a King Quad or other Suzuki Utility Sport ATV, you can get a free Warn winch, and you can add a Warn wireless control system for only $69. See your local participating Suzuki dealer for the best in ATVs. You better act quickly, because unlike Suzuki ATVs, these deals won't last.
DW, you're gonna love the changes that David and I have made to the Aaron's Dream Machine. comfortable reclining seat, onboard computer, awesome sound system.
It's a rolling Aaron's store.
The Aaron's car tomorrow.
If you want brand new name brand furniture, electronics, appliances, and computers all in one place and with no credit checks, shop Aaron's.
Hey, Mikey, where do you want these?
In the car, of course.
You know, Mikey, I'm starting to like this car.
Do the math. Nobody beats Aaron's.
How can I help you?
Well, I'm going back and forth about redoing my floors over Labor Day. I just wish there was something that could help me decide.
How does not paying for 12 months sound?
That'll do it.
Just put $299 on your Lowe's consumer credit card and don't pay a penny for 12 months on anything in the store.
This?
Yep.
This?
Mm-hmm.
This?
On anything.
So, what do you say to get you to do the floors?
You don't pay for 12 months with this.
That'll do it.
Save now at Lowe's Labor Day event. Pay later if you spend $299 or more on your Lowe's credit card.
250,000 laps, 275,000 miles, zero race failures. Get the same reliable technology the pros run with Mallory. Power up and go with a Hi-Fire 6 ignition and ProMaster coil. Multi-spark energy and high-output design means more power. Plus, get a new Mallory 42 Series distributor. Delivers precision timing for an instant throttle response. Race reliable and built for the street. Mallory's ignition systems. Bulletproof performance for your hot rod, muscle car, or truck. Make it Mallory.
Welcome back to Gateway International Raceway. Frank Kimmel is on pit road with the number 46. They are putting four fresh tires on this thing, and there is some sort of a problem underneath the hood. They had to push him to get him restarted here. They come back down pit road on lap 87. We'll try to follow up with crew chief Bill Kimmel and get an update.
Yeah, and it was weird. It seemed like he might not have first gear, because when he had it revved up and was trying to start, and it just dropped way down, like he was starting in second or third gear even.
Yeah, he had a clutch problem last week, won the race, overcame that clutch problem in Milwaukee and won the race. There's crew chief and brother Bill Kimmel right there.
And Ray. So I'm sure we're going to hear that story
shortly. We're trying to get in position here. Bill, can you give us an update? What's the situation?
Not sure. He said after the red flag, it went back green. It's got a miss upstairs, so I'm not really sure if we found a plug or what we did as we sat down there. Wasn't getting any better. We checked the plug wires, things like that. Nothing seems to have helped it. So he said it was coming and going at the end. So maybe if it runs 10, 12 more laps, it gets enough heat in it, it'll clear him out a little bit. But this doesn't look like it's going to be our night. So we'll keep fighting and see if we can't get the port car back up there.
Okay, so the two came down and went to the pits and put on fresh tires, and now we'll have to follow up the situation with the 46 and see if they can ride this thing out for another 30 laps.
Ray, the good news right now, only 17 cars on the lead lap. Obviously, Frank pitting this time will be 17th in line. The two of Michael McDowell gave up the lead to come down pit road, and he will restart this race in the 11th position.
So Michael McDowell giving up the lead, coming onto pit road, feeling that's his best option. Obviously, they were a little concerned about fuel. That would have been a long run.
Maybe a lot concerned.
They're a lot concerned about fuel and the benefit of Frank Kimmel not running well, or potentially not running well, gave them the opportunity to come onto pit road and not have to gamble.
You know, it's funny. I was talking to Frank Kimmel, you know, before the race, and I said, do you run this race with one eye on the two, or do you run this race trying to win every race? He said, well, you know, we've been in this thing a long time. We've won 8 championships. We've run for points just about our entire ARCA REMAX career. So we would be lying if we didn't, you know, if we said we didn't think about what they were doing. But at the end of the day, you have to run your own race. And right now, you're having a problem with the engine. That's why Frank came down pit road. We knew that he probably had enough fuel to get to the end, but he was backing up on the racetrack. So they took a cursory look at the plug wires to make sure they didn't have a plug wire come off, try to put more tires on because he, you know, might as well, because he already gave up his track position. So they are cognizant of what Michael McDowell is doing, but at the end of the day, they have to do what's best for them.
And at the beginning of the show, we talked about Mark Mitchell, Josh Wise grabbing his first career pole, and we thought, well, they're not really the story because it's going to be Michael McDowell and Frank Kimmel. Well, all of a sudden, they're back into the forefront of the story. We've got Brian Clausen out in front, Justin Allgaier, Dominic Cassola. That 87 of Andy Lally is running fourth, and fifth is the 22 of Josh Wise. So right back up to the front. I think they always say the cream rises to the top.
And remember, Josh was penalized after that accident he was involved in for pitting too soon. Mm-hmm. So he made the most recent restart from the back of the field. He's worked his way up into the top five right now, running fifth. Again, a lot of those cars that were on the lead lap came down pit road, but Josh has passed some cars also.
Coming out of turn four, we're about to see the green flag once again. And we've had five cautions. The green flag back in the air. We're back to racing. Two and three wide, almost on the start of this one. Ryan Clausen slow on the restart. He was leading when the green flag came out. Here comes Justin Allgaier to the inside.
They've got the lap car of Aaron Crocker. They just unlapped herself right in front of them, side by side for the lead. Justin on the bottom, going to be able to pull out in front of Brian Clausen to take over the lead.
Justin Allgaier looking for another win in the ARCA RE/MAX Series. He won in his hometown of Springfield on the dirt a year ago. Looking to make it two wins in this series now.
Boy, would he like to get a win on pavement, too. And right here in St. Louis would be a big, big day for Justin Allgaier.
So Allgaier out in front now of the 40 of Brian Clausen. Dominic Cassola running in third in that number one. Andy Lowley in the 87. And rounding out the top five is Josh Wise in the 22.
There's here heavy traffic right there. There's Michael McDowell right off your screen in that two car.
Get fresh tires on that number two as he tries to make the pass, taking positions away.